Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 3, 4, 5 and 6 in private and for the next week's meeting to be in private session. Are members content to go forward on that basis? Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session on Scotland's tourism and hospitality sectors. This session is designed to provide the committee with a snapshot of the sectors as we recover from the pandemic and in recognition of the important role they play in Scotland's economy. We have two panels this morning. Can I welcome the first panel, Mark Crothall, Chief Executive of the Scottish Tourism Alliance, Stephen Montgomery, Spokesperson, Scottish Hospitality Group, and Leon Thompson, Executive Director, UK Hospitality Scotland. Welcome to the committee. Can I ask all witnesses and members if they could keep their questions concise and to the point? That would be helpful for our timings this morning. Can I start by asking a question of the panellists? We have obviously been living through the pandemic. It's been extremely difficult for hospitality and tourism sectors. And in more recent months, the Omicron variant presented further challenges at the end of 2021 and into the new year. Can I ask about the support that was available? Obviously, Omicron was to some degree unexpected and support had to, was an attempt to deliver support quickly. Can I perhaps go to, I will allow all members to answer. If you can be brief, please, in the answer, that would be helpful. I'll invite all witnesses. I'll invite Leon Thompson to come in first.
Good morning, convener. Thank you very much for the question. The Omicron variant caught everybody by surprise, as you said, and the restrictions combined with public health messaging really impacted massively on the sector. So with that happening, the Scottish Government did move to find funds and to make them available for impacted businesses. The funding was never intended to cover losses, but was intended to help with cash flow issues. Around about 100 million was made available for hospitality businesses, and then a further 5 million for nightclubs that were ordered to close, and 10 million made available for businesses impacted by the table service only regulations. The funding, as far as I'm aware, is still actually making its way out to businesses, which is very disappointing because this was really money that was needed in the immediate aftermath of the announcements from Public Health Scotland and then restrictions being imposed by the Scottish Government. So whilst the money was helpful when it was announced, we still have businesses waiting to receive their funds.
Thompson, can we bring in Stephen Montgomery next? And can I ask if the way in which the businesses have been identified, I mean, I understand there's a desire for flexibility, but was that is that approach been helpful and has it reached businesses that need the support?
Thank you, convener, and thank you very much for inviting me today for today's session. I think I concur with what my colleague Leon has just said there. However, what I would say is that it wasn't targeted the way it has been distributed. It was done through the same old way we did it way back, where it was done through the non-domestic rate system. So it didn't matter how affected you were with Omicron, you still got the funding. And it has always been the job of the task force, who myself and my colleague Leon are on, to make sure that funding was targeted. However, that hasn't been the case. And I've spent all this week trying to get onto different councils to get this funding out. And the same went for the table service fund, which has been out as well. There's still no applications out for that. And that is going to public houses who have been affected, yes. However, there are many public houses which are actually restaurants and restaurants which are actually public houses, depending on how they're on the NDR register.
Thank you. And Mr. Crothall, can I maybe ask you to comment on this and also on the way in which funding is delivered? The previous two witnesses have both spoken about they would like to see more targeted funding, but is it a challenge in trying to get the money out quickly? Is there a balance to be struck between getting the money quickly out the door and doing something that is more granular in terms of identifying who actually needs that kind of support?
Thank you, convener, and again, thank you all for inviting me to this session. That is the biggest challenge. Obviously, in a short period of time, of how can you get money quickly into businesses? And you know, the sector is very diverse and very wide, and obviously the hospitality sector in itself has a lot of different components to it. But looking at the broader tourism industry as a whole, the range of self-catering properties to guest houses, hostels, tour operators, everyone in one way or another was directly impacted by Omicron. So having a balanced and fair and proportionate response is always going to be hard, but ones that a response that would make the most impact or provide the most impact and support was going to be difficult to, and 100 million plus the extra on top for the tourism sector was never ever going to achieve that goal. So we would obviously support a much more targeted and concentrated measures, but again, would not want any business to fail. And most significantly, as we all know, the Christmas window was a critical time for all businesses in the sector, particularly the hospitality sector and many in the more immediate supply chain, to make their cash to see them through these next 3 months. And there lies the big challenge of the liquidity of businesses. The Scottish Tourism Alliance conducted a survey over the Christmas period, which was part of a UK-wide survey, which my colleagues in England and Wales have done. And again, to assess the sort of impact of cash liquidity in business, and over 53% had said they have less than 2 months cash reserves to be able to navigate their way through. So grant support is you know, hugely important everyone, and the blend of respondents to that survey were far and wide. It wasn't just the hospitality community, it was tour operators as well as other people as well, and obviously the impact of no international business and trade that would come in with festivals cancelled as well. That was the last hurrah for any potential inbound activity too. So targeted response, going back to your first point, really important, but again, unless the level of support is of significant amounts, it's very difficult to make it meaningful for any business in this current climate.
Thank you. I'll now hand over to Alexander Burnett, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. No, my register of interest around tourism. If I could just ask a quick question on the support for the longer term recovery. I had a good meeting with Visit Scotland a few weeks back, who explained that during COVID, they've been able to pivot their budget to be more focused on capital expenditure projects in readiness for the return of tourism. I just wonder if you could comment on how effective you think that's been and whether that approach has ended, or if not, should it? And if so, to what extent? Maybe Leon first, and then Stephen, and then Mark.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the question. I mean, the hospitality sector needs as much support as it can get right now. I mean, we're not out of the woods with the pandemic and the ongoing challenges that the sector faces. And anything that Visit Scotland can do is very welcome. You know, particularly around promoting and marketing Scotland and hospitality as part of its activities for this year, because ultimately, what we need a strong year of trade ahead of us, and we need to be able to attract in visitors. We've done well with the domestic market, but we really need a big focus on the international market and the business market as well, because that's the kind of spend that's going to make the difference to businesses which are looking at their depleted cash reserves and wondering how they're going to manage to continue. So that's, I think, from a hospitality point of view, I think that's a key ask of Visit Scotland, is actually sort of, you know, getting that marketing and promotion message right and to the right audiences, so that we can start welcoming people back in good numbers and people coming back with delivering high levels of spend, which is the case with international visitors and certainly business visitors as well. I mean, beyond that, I mean, the big focus for UK Hospitality Scotland is pushing the UK government to retain VAT at 12.5%. That's a key a measure that would make a big difference to hospitality in the coming months. And with the Scottish government, it's a conversation around business rate relief and whether the 50%, which is in place through from April to the end of July, can now perhaps be extended further through the financial year, particularly given the losses incurred by businesses over Christmas and New Year.
Thank you. If you have a witness who would like to comment.
Steve Montgomery, would you like to...
Yes, thanks very much indeed, Mr. Bev, for the question. I think I concur exactly again with what my colleague Liam has just said there. And if you look at today, where the parliamentary inquiry in Westminster, where the APPBG, which is the all-party parliamentary beer group, have launched an inquiry into the rates system in England, where the effect that the business rates have had on the licensed trade sector in England. And I think that's something that, going back on what Leon has just said there, that's something that maybe needs to be set up in Scotland, where we can have an all-party discussion on how we look at business rates again. And the fact that in December, we were all looking forward to, obviously, a bumper Christmas, however, with Omicron hitting us, costing the sector in the region of just over £1 billion of turnover, the fact that we're getting a rates relief now for the following 22-23 year is probably out the window. And that rates relief for many, because it's capped at £27,500 per business, is only, as far as SHG members are concerned, probably equates to about 3% saving. So we really need to look at that very, very soon, so we can look at how we save businesses money going forward, because this recovery isn't going to happen overnight. Customer confidence is really, really low, so we need positive messaging coming out from all parts of government. Whether it be the current government and the opposition as well. So that really needs to be a key feature in any recovery for hospitality.
Thank you. And Mark, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes, I do. And thank you again for the question. I think this has to be a joined up effort in terms of recovery. I think the importance of international has been well stated. Pre-COVID, there were 3.9 million international visitors coming and spending a significantly greater amount than the domestic market. We would anticipate as well that there will be an outbound spike this year, and we will see many more domestic holiday makers who've supported the industry over the last 2 years exiting and going out abroad. There's a recent survey done only in the last couple of days by a well-respected organisation in Scotland that said 59% of Scottish adults are still likely to take a break, are likely to take a holiday break, but only met perhaps one break this year. The cost of household budgets being stretched, etc., is important. So investing in that international piece is absolutely key. And I know Visit Scotland have got a lot of activity already happening, but we can't lose sight of the need to support tour operator community and the supply chain that very much broker a lot of that activity, and then service and deliver on the ground, which in turn feeds into the hospitality community and also, of course, importantly, the attractions and the adventure operators. So there's a combination of right conditions, I think, that need to happen to drive resilient recovery, favourable financing conditions for servicing debt and enabling ongoing investment so the sector can stay competitive. As Stephen was just referring to there, the level of relief in the business rates is very, very small in comparison. And for a large operator or any operator that is looking to be diverse and actually adapt to the net zero agenda, it doesn't really help them at all, particularly with loss of income over the festive period. Having a supportive fiscal policy and proportionate legislation and a consistent policy response, and obviously being well coordinated. But and again, allowing businesses to embrace technology. So the Digital Boost Programme, very, very good, and industry have been very innovative. But it is a variety of funding, and the recommendations that STERG have put forward as part of the phase two recovery proposals, obviously we would ask and hope that they would be looked upon favourably and supported, as well as the in process of delivery that need to be sustained going beyond that too. But business rates relief, low levels of VAT, and as with Leon, the tourism at Scottish Tourism Alliance, we sit on the UK Tourism Industry Council, and going back to the survey that I referred to earlier, part of that survey's intention is to also help inform the Treasury with to try and swing the favourable response from them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I know colleagues will be coming out in on much of what you said, so that's my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman, who will be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I've got a couple of questions, but I want to start with a question around numbers, occupancy rates, footfall. What we've seen over the last, I suppose, particularly the last few months, how have things looked in your respective sectors, and what does it look like? Do you think? What are you projecting for this coming year? Thinking quite short term at the moment. And if I could ask Mark first, and then Leon and Stephen.
Thank you for the question. I'll let my colleague Leon probably update on the occupancy levels in the hotel sector. But I guess there's also very different sort of positions here. The cities, in particular, have been heavily hit in terms of occupancy and forward book, and a lot of that is, you know, the need for international visitors, but also business tourism, which, you know, the value of business tourism was 2 billion to the tourism, total tourism pot pre-COVID. So the cities have a very different challenge, and there are many rural properties, those in the honey spots, but and have actually been well managed and have got a good loyal following, have done okay. And there is, you know, there are forward bookings. However, and the self-catering sector is also reporting, you know, relatively strong bookings as well for the first quarter and looking beyond. I guess there's a watch out there as people may choose to go abroad now. We saw last year where there were a lot of bookings being held for self-catering and bed and breakfast, etc. And then there was a flip where those domestic bookings were cancelled. And people chose to go abroad in the short windows that they had. And a lot of people have also now refrained from sort of taking sizable deposits, etc. So there's a challenge there. We know, again, from the golf tourism sector, which has carried over a lot of their bookings into this year, their challenge now is to find capacity and accommodation for any new bookings that are coming in 2022, let alone golf tee times. So the importance of, again, going back and building that future pipeline of businesses is important too. But it, you know, it remains a challenge, and it's certainly not at the level that we would want it to be. The first quarter of, we asked in our survey again, what is the percentage of booking, a percentage of businesses that had seen more than 50% cancellation or should I say decline in their bookings for the first quarter. And it was, I think, in excess of 50% as well. So, you know, again, not confident, but hopefully with messages changing recently, there will be an upturn. But I don't think we can be 100% reliant on a shored up book going forward. But self-catering sector, definitely probably the one that's likely to perform the strongest in the first quarter. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Mark. Stephen, if I could bring you in, and if you could also speak about the rural-urban difference, if there is one that Mark has identified.
Thank you very much for the question. I think it's more Leon's bag, I think, on this one, as far as UKH is concerned, as far as the hotel sector is concerned, but on SHG, you can only comment for where we are. Certainly, and we operate throughout rural and city centres, and as Mark has alluded to there, city centres have been really hit hard because of the footfall with the work from home message, and that's going to take a long, long time to get back. Rurally, again, depending on restrictions, because customer confidence is really at an all-time low, and that came a real impact whenever the Public Health Scotland message came out in December. So if you take a wet sales as far as pubs where only draft or alcohol is sold and no food is sold, they took a real massive hit in December and will take a long one before they get back. Been down to probably 25% occupancy as far as footfall is concerned because it was table service. But again, I go back to the same thing. It's going to be customer confidence that gets people back. And that it's not just city centres, that's rural as well. But I have to say that hospitality will have to play a big part in city centres to help retail as well. And retail will have to play a big part to help hospitality. And together, that will obviously hopefully bring people back in. And the need to bring people back into the office help us all.
Thank you, Stephen. And Leon, interested to hear your thoughts.
Yes, thank you. I mean, to add to the comments and observations from colleagues, I mean, members in the hotel sector, I mean, they're in the cities, they're reporting occupancy rates of about 20-30% at the moment, and you know, little sort of confidence that they'll be adding to those for the they'll be adding to that level this month, and things look, you know, at the moment look sort of fairly static. Cities have been very badly impacted. And so that remains the case. And this is why we really need to see a big uptick in international visitors, but also in terms of business visits as well, because it's those business visitors who will sort of add the numbers and the spend to occupancy rates for hotels. In rural areas, as Mark mentioned, I mean, it's a bit of a different picture because, you know, forward bookings do look good for spring and summer as people are looking for holidays. And as we know from previously in the pandemic, rural and coastal areas have performed quite strongly as people have chosen to not go to cities. For the cities, we really need to see some energy injected into the offer. You know, we need to see the return of events in our cities, giving people more reasons to be there, to really sort of, you know, highlight the great experiences that people can have in our cities safely. That's absolutely critical. There is a city centre task force advisory group which I've been invited to join, and that will hopefully help to sort of, you know, frame out some of the response to support our city centres as they seek to recover. Thanks.
Thanks very much for that. I suppose I'm now interested in thinking longer term. We know that international experts are saying that full recovery doesn't look likely until at least 2024. And I suppose there's a question about how we deal with the next 2 years. But are there discussions in your respective sectors around actually full recovery in 2024 won't look like what the sectors looked like pre-COVID? What innovation, what changes, what diversification is happening? And what are the pressure points that you need us to be sort of focusing on or targeting to ensure that we do actually have a vibrant and sustainable tourism and hospitality sectors going forward, especially if we think about non-pandemic challenges like the climate emergency and that kind of thing? Just go through all three, if you can briefly. Mark, do you want to start?
Yeah, thank you very much. A very good question. I mean, I was just going to come back in there and just clarify. It was 34% of businesses who responded who said their booking levels were down by 50% in the first quarter. I think they're on the positive, though. I think there are some obviously things to take away from here. In the 9 months of this fiscal year, we've seen 480 new startups and new enterprises come into the sector. So clearly, there's entrepreneurship out there, and there are businesses already in the sector who have done a lot of investment into technology and actually finding different ways of bringing different product to market. The absolute critical need, though, is for us to be competitive in terms of the offering and respond to what the consumer trends are telling us and what the actual customer expectation is. We've seen obviously a lot of growth, or there's a lot of new development in hotel stock as well in the cities. The new Virgin properties opening up in both Glasgow and Edinburgh in the coming weeks. And we've also seen, again, a good number of acquisitions taking place. Only yesterday in the rural parts, with Argyle Holidays, for example, have just transacted their business for over 100 million, which is a sizable investment from a business. And there are many other investors coming in. And that, in one respect, has to be a good thing, because you hope those investors will bring the much needed finance that will help transform some of these properties. But you do have to ask the question as to why those operators, many of whom have been long established, have actually decided to get out. I think possibly the strains of the last 2 years have taken their toll on them. The Scottish Tourism Emergency Response Group and the task force recommendations go back to responding to the needs of what needs to be done. Labour supply is absolutely, again, probably one of the most critical situations we face. We can drive demand and grow all the demand that we want, but we still do not have a workforce of sufficient size and scale to be able to deliver the volume and the capacity levels we would want. So solutions to that, again, are urgent, and there's a number of initiatives underway, and we continue to invest in the workforce that we have already. The Scottish the observatory project, which is one of the first phase projects announced, again, is one that needs to be sustained, because that will provide a repository of insights and data that can inform both marketing initiatives and investment plans, and importantly, businesses to make, you know, less risky decisions on the investment that they have, given that there are capital is probably going to be very challenged. So I would, you know, just refer back to all of the first and second phase proposals that have been tabled by the emergency response group, each one being of you know, high importance. It's how do you prioritise them as the challenge, but people, without question, remains, you know, a critical need. And to Stephen's point about messaging, and again, I think everybody, the more negative messaging and the more restrictive messaging that comes out around the uncertainty doesn't do our recruitment activity any favours whatsoever. And we need to be positive about the opportunities in the sector that previously employed 229,000 people before COVID, virtually 1 in 11 in the economy. Thank you for that.
Thanks, Mark. Stephen.
Yeah, thank you very much. And again, yeah, a very, very good question. I think hospitality is still facing really significant challenges and suffering from probably long-term effects of the pandemic. You know, we've got supplier increases, we've got utility increases, all that going forward. Recruitment crisis, Mark's just put there. And, you know, even in the Business in Scotland 2021 publication that the Scottish Government put out, you know, we've seen, was it 1,000 businesses were lost between 2020 and 2021 in the accommodation and food sector. So we need to be looking at that. And I think BBC reported last year that it was 9.7 fewer restaurants in mid-2021. I think we really need to be looking at city centres as well, where we've seen during the as we come out of the lockdowns, where we're allowed to have outside trading. So that is a key thing for hospitality and city centres, where that will also help the retail, because we've seen where it gives people, the customers, a customer choice, where we were allowed to have, say, alcohol outside, but we weren't allowed to have alcohol inside, so that produced outside trading. And I think in Edinburgh, Glasgow, and all the major cities, they were allowing pavement service, etc. And I think that's a fundamental issue going forward, where we need to be looking at the licensing to allow that to continue, for our, especially for our inbound traffic and our local traffic, where tourism can continue that, because it gives that people, and dare say, the European feel, if you like, where we can sit outside or have that choice, which will give people the customer confidence. And I think, as back to what Mark was saying there on the recruitment, our own group, Scottish Hospitality Group, we've now, and I don't know where Colin's aware of this, however, but I'll invite Colin to attend one of the meetings where we've actually been involved, myself, in devising a training programme with Dumfries and Galway Council, which is going to be hopefully released at the end of February to pilot, where it's a 12-week course, and that will be for anybody from 16 to 60 who has either wanted to get into hospitality or has been, as we would call them, silver servers, who have been in hospitality before, got married, had their kids and their kids in the university and want to come back into some kind of part-time work, where we are able to give that, you know, part-time work. So that will be a 12-week course. It will all be about barista training, it will be about cocktail training, it will be about everything, front of house, housekeeping, all that kind of thing. So we're trying to play a major part here in working with government and taking our own initiatives to try and solve that recruitment basis, because you know, we haven't got the European workers anymore. So we now have to start looking at where we build for the future, because this isn't going to be an overnight stopgap. But if we can get this 12-week course started and it's recurring, it can then, if it goes well, it can be looked at to be you know, devised in other areas of Scotland and different councils.
Thanks very much for that, Stephen. And Leon.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the question. I mean, businesses appreciate that things have changed and that, you know, recovery will take a while. One of the key things that we really need, first of all, from the Scottish Government is a clear roadmap through through the situation that we're currently in, and a strategic framework which largely discounts restrictions and closure and so on, because these are the things which are holding hospitality back from really getting on the road to recovery. So that's really the first thing to say. The other thing I wanted to highlight was that hospitality is a very resilient and adaptable sector as well, and it's shown that throughout pandemic. So even despite the challenges which are all there, which Mark and Stephen have referenced just now, which I highlighted in the paper that I put through to the committee, you know, there is still positivity out there in the sector in terms of what it can do, in terms of what it can deliver, in terms of what the future can look like. But, you know, we need our businesses to be in a position where they are free to trade and to operate, free from restrictions and and challenges put in place, and really that's the key thing for our businesses. We know that we've got changed behaviours in terms of customers as well. A couple of things to say around that. Consumer confidence has been mentioned already, and that is something that we need to rebuild and restore. And you know, we look forward to working with the Scottish Government to do that and encourage more people back out into hospitality and to take breaks in Scotland and other parts of Scotland as well. We also know that business travel is unlikely to return to the levels that it was at before. Businesses are obviously looking to save money. One way of doing that is for people not to to travel for business quite so much, and that obviously links in with the net zero agenda as well, which you mentioned, which is obviously a really important issue for hospitality as well. But the sector is looking at how it can change, how it can adapt, and things like net zero, absolutely, you know, one of the top priorities for hospitality there, and the sector is working hard to lower its emissions and working with organisations like Carbon Zero Forum. That's actually providing roadmaps for hospitality businesses so that they can reduce their emissions. And that all ties in with Scotland being a sustainable destination as well. And hospitality is a key part in achieving that.
Thank you very much. Thanks, convener.
As we've touched on labour market issues, I'm going to bring Gordon MacDonald in next. But can I first of all just clarify with Leon? You talked about the City Centre Task Force Advisory Group, Leon. Is that the one that's centred around Glasgow in particular? Or?
No, this is something which has been driven by the Scottish Government. I can send you more details of that, convener, if that would be helpful. Send that across after the meeting.
That's helpful. Thank you, Gordon.
Okay, thanks very much, convener. Just to move on the labour issues, clearly we're all hoping that hotels return to their previous pre-COVID and pre-Brexit occupancy levels, and that restaurants start taking up the opportunities when people start travelling again, whether it's staycationers, business travellers or international tourists. But in order to do that, we need the staff. Now, Leon, you said in your briefing that you gave us that there were 340,000 vacancies in the UK and around 40,000 in Scotland, with 40% of businesses were not confident in their ability to recruit staff during 2022. What do we need to do to take up these challenges and take advantage of the opportunities? How do we close that labour shortage gap?
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you for that. The labour shortages is probably the most pressing issue for a lot of businesses right now, who are kind of looking at higher levels of trade in the coming months and wondering where, you know, how they're going to actually manage to deliver everything that they need to. The key thing here is that there's not one way of actually managing this and finding a solution to it. It's going to take a collaborative effort between industry and also our governments as well, so Scottish Government and UK Government, to actually achieve an uptick in applications for the vacancies which exist at the moment. We're also facing the short-term challenges, but we're also facing long-term challenges as well. So in the short term, what we need to do is encourage more people to consider jobs and careers in the sector. You know, perhaps people who are not working at the moment, and looking at school leavers as well, and encouraging them into the sector. Department for Work and Pensions, we work very closely with them around Kickstart. And also on other initiatives as well to bring people into the workplace, and we really feel that, you know, jobs and careers are in hospitality are great opportunities for young people, and indeed people of all ages. So we're working very closely with government departments on their initiatives to maximise the benefit that can come to hospitality through being involved in in those particular initiatives and schemes. So it's that kind of activity, as well as the work which we had last year with the Scottish Government, where there was a £100,000 social media campaign run to encourage primarily younger people to consider jobs and careers in hospitality. It's that kind of activity that can help in the short term. Longer term, we need to sort of get the talent pipeline back on track. We've had 2 years of disruption, and there is still a lot of interest and a lot of people coming through hospitality courses in our colleges, but that has been disrupted. And hopefully we'll begin to see that starting to be repaired, and we'll start seeing those people coming through into jobs in hospitality, and that will help as well. We do also need to kind of look at our immigration system as well. We haven't got one, you know, post Brexit. We don't have an immigration system which is fit for purpose. We really need the UK government to look urgently at that. Look at additional routes for people to come and work in the UK, come and work in Scotland, lowering perhaps some of the visa thresholds. That would certainly help. And we need some creative thinking as well around areas like the youth mobility scheme as well. You know, can that be extended out to more countries? Can that be extended out to the EU 27, so that we can have young people coming to Scotland, working here, perhaps in peak seasons, but also you know, perhaps at other points in the year as well. That would be beneficial, I believe, for cultural exchange, but also exchange of skills as well, because there are you know, lots of great hospitality schools in Europe. Wouldn't it be great if we could attract young people who have been through those schools and that training into our hospitality businesses here? So there's no quick fix. There's no sort of one way of doing this. It's about using all the initiatives which are there. It's important to talk up the sector as a destination for our young people, and in the long term, you know, we have to accept that, you know, Scotland will rely on labour coming from overseas to work in our businesses.
I was wanting to ask you on that point that Leon's just raised about we need a new immigration system to attract, whether it's the visas that the hospitality industry called upon last year and was rejected by the UK government. We're at a situation where we're at a record low of unemployment in Scotland at 3.6%, below the level it's considered to be full employment. And we're in a situation where Edinburgh, at a briefing of Edinburgh Chamber of Commerce on Friday, they said that the hospitality trade, particularly in Edinburgh, and the employees, 90% were EU nationals. Many of them went home because of the pandemic and because of the ending of free movement of travel. They're having difficulty in returning. So again, it's back to how do we close the gap, Mark?
Question. I mean, Leon has raised some very good points, which I absolutely think we all support. I mean, the Scottish Tourism Alliance were having these conversations with the Scottish Government and the UK Government pre-COVID around the challenge that we face as an industry around being, which was thriving, of course, to fill the labour gaps, not just in hospitality. And I would stress the point, the challenge of shortage of labour is not just in one part of our industry. It's right across the sectors, whether it's in visitor attractions or outdoor adventure operators. And there's a number of factors. So we do need to have a better visa system. Our industry is an international industry, and culture and language and everything is hugely important. People go around the world to embrace the different cultures, but also want to be able to have, you know, people who can guide them with the right language and deliver their own vibrancy in the communities. And going back to the city centre, we need city centre vibrancy. I'm just picking up on what we're doing in the short term again, to touch on the tourism hospitality talent development programme that has been invested in by Scottish Government over the last year since COVID, again, first phase and second phase action. The business response to that has been coordinated by the industry with the Hospitality Industry Trust and the Scottish Tourism Alliance. We've had over 2,000 colleagues come through the first programme of online activity, focusing primarily on supervisory management and leadership programmes. Again, as Leon pointed to, it's about bridging that gap of where is that supervisory talent and how can we upskill quickly to get people to be more effective and obviously be able to earn more money as well on top, and if, and productivity improves. The success of that programme has been funded again through the Innovation Fund, and we're very delighted now we've got 1,450 applicants coming onto the programme again from right across the sector as a whole. It's not just hospitality. So again, commitment by industry to invest in their workforce currently, recognising the challenge. And some of the challenges we saw where there was a draw and appeal to the industry to come and work in the sector over the last few months during COVID, actually the retention of those individuals was quite, the attrition of those individuals was very high. And that we put down to the frontline managers who would normally induct and give that new entrant a very passive way and it's good experience of coming into the place of work, were actually had their, excuse my expression, had their heads down the toilets, physically cleaning the toilets and unable to look after the people that they would want to do so. So it was, it is a challenge, but we have to see some changes in the immigration system to get more freedom of movement in place and attract more talent in. And I think I've always said, and we work, Stephen is also very closely working with Springboard on the advisory board, organisations like that, bringing young people, as well as those who have perhaps had a bad start in life, into a sector that can create employment and actually accelerate careers very quickly through the industry as a whole. It's not just, you know, being a waiter or a barman. There are digital marketeers, there are accountants, there's engineers on mountain railways. We say tourism is everyone's business. And that message needs to be reinforced by the teaching community, the secondary school community, and really profiled as well by all of us in society. And I think the parent forum also have a big part to play in getting a true understanding of what a career in tourism actually can deliver for anybody of any age in this current climate. Thank you.
And Stephen, you know, we've highlighted that there is a need to attract new talent into the hospitality industry. And given that we're at full employment and given the situation with a lot of EU nationals leaving the country pre-pandemic and the lack of a hospitality visa, Edinburgh Chamber of Commerce highlighted on Friday that there should be a devolved immigration policy. Is that something that your group would support?
Absolutely. Anything that will help get, you know, the talent from anywhere in the world into Scotland to you know, support us in recruitment, we would absolutely support. I mean, SHG took part in the Westminster Scottish Affairs Committee, where I brought that up. You know, and we've had various meetings to try and encourage UK government to open up the visas system, you know, to do that. But, you know, going back to where we are with recruitment now, I think I've always been one to go back to basics. And I think we need to bust the myth of hospitality being long hours, badly paid, badly run, all that kind of thing. You know, whenever you see the adverts for the army, you don't say, you hear them saying the advertising that they're going to war, they're going to do this, that, the other. You hear them talk about a great career, a great this, whatever, and come out of that. Hospitality Rising is a great initiative that's been done now, where we're aiming to raise £5 million to try and do a TV advert. An advertising, you know, throughout the whole of the country to try and encourage people in. And it's things like going back into schools and getting into secondary schools really early. And I do that through Springboard, and hopefully getting back into classrooms very, very soon to try and to do that. We're sometimes getting them too late. And it's about trying to longer term look at foundation apprenticeships, modern apprenticeships, and doing some work in the workplace that will try and encourage people, not just to come into hospitality, but those who have been in hospitality for years and years to come back, because of the myth-busting thing that, you know, hospitality is a bad place to work. We need to look at the well-being of our staff. We need to open up the books again and look at everything that can make our staff feel comfortable, make them feel valued, and make them see that they're well-paid as well.
Thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, panel. One thing that's come home to me in the course of evidence-taking is the sheer complexity of the hospitality and tourism business, And it's incredibly diverse, and especially if you start taking into account local and international supply chains and so forth, you're talking about a fairly complicated beast to deal with, which, again, to me, makes it quite difficult to do targeted support for one particular sector when the knock-on effect all the way through the businesses is extremely complex. I'd like to ask, overall, we've talked about various parts of the hospitality and tourism business. How would you describe the overall financial status of the business, particularly in terms of cash flows and, importantly, debt levels that some of them may have taken on in the course of the COVID emergency and maybe hangovers from before as well? Maybe I could ask Liam Thompson to kick off with that.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the question. I mean, businesses are really at the end of whatever cash reserves that they had sort of leading up to Christmas. I mean, that period that of sort of 6 to 8 weeks would have given businesses a huge boost in revenue to sort of sustain them into through the early months of this year, because Christmas and Hogmanay didn't happen, not in the way that businesses expected. That's put additional pressure onto to those businesses that were already struggling with cash reserves. So, I mean, you know, we're looking at somewhere around 2/3 of businesses, according to the ONS, had less than 3 months of reserves. This was from a survey that they published in December 2021, and about a quarter saying that they depleted their cash reserves.
So can I just break in there and ask you, you're talking about 2,000 businesses. As we've already agreed, the hospitality and tourism business as a whole is incredibly complex. Where are those 2,000 businesses in terms of the overall picture? Who are they? Are they hotels? Are they
the 2,000 businesses? Is that you're referring to the STA survey?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I was giving you some statistics from the ONS Business Insights and Conditions survey, which was published in December 2021. So that's UK-wide snapshots of what's happening. But I mean, in terms of the STA survey that was run, I mean, that was a very broad sweep of hospitality and tourism businesses. A good number of my members, hotels, bars, restaurants, they participated in that that survey. Businesses from the accommodation self-catering side were included in there. Also visitor attractions, activity providers and so on. I mean, Mark will have a clearer picture of all the sectors that that made up that that responded to that survey. So it's a very broad sweep of businesses, but you know, presents I would say a very accurate picture of where businesses are right now in terms of their cash reserves. You also asked as well about debt levels. I mean, debt levels are at an all-time record, and you know, those debts are now having to be paid back as well, which is obviously putting additional pressure on businesses that you know, many businesses that are really only starting to begin to trade again after the Christmas and New Year restrictions. So they're, you know, they're in very, very challenging circumstances. And that's for larger entities as well as for smaller businesses as well. So the financial pressures are right across the board.
Just to clarify in my own head, the 2,000 businesses referred to in the survey were across the UK.
So if we're talking about the STA survey, then those are Scottish businesses.
Okay, so the 2,000 businesses you referred to are Scottish businesses alone.
Did I refer to 2,000 businesses?
Yes, you did.
Right, okay. Well, I was certainly quoting figures from the ONS Business Insights and Conditions survey.
So the 2,000 businesses were from the ONS survey?
I suspect there would have been more than 2,000 businesses covered as part of that survey.
Okay, thank you for that. Maybe I could ask Mark Crothall to come in and comment there.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Yeah, just to provide probably a bit of clarity around the Scottish position, because we can give you the breakdown by type of business that is in financial difficulty, is reported as being in financial difficulty. But I just like to come back to your I think one of in your opening remark, you know, the complexity of the sector is one, and the consequential impacts of other things in the sector or out with the sector that have a direct bearing on the business's ability to be able to trade. And it sort of goes back to the labour one as well. The significance of a lack of affordable housing and the right sort of accommodation and the transport infrastructure, as well as being critical to do that. But coming to the point around financial difficulty, we surveyed 1,335 businesses, of which 26% of that total were hotels and guest houses and bed and breakfasts. 10%, just 130 odd pubs, bars, restaurants, cafes responded. A good proportion, 36% self-catering caravan parks, and then visitor attractions were just under 10% as well, and tour operators again in the similar park. From serviced accommodation, again, that's hotels, guest houses, 78% said that they were in financial difficulty. Unserviced accommodation, the self-catering sector that have had strong, relatively strong trade. Not all those properties, I would point out, have traded at the same level. The larger self-catering properties were very much impeded by restrictions, so unable to trade. 54% of them in financial difficulty. Pubs, bars, restaurants, which are the most volatile and again have had to be probably the biggest, so dependent on the footfall into the cities and where many of them exist, 84% of the 100 plus pubs, bars and restaurants in financial difficulty. 62% of the attractions that responded were saying the same. And tour operators again, and those businesses, coach operators, heavily dependent on international movement, 76%. They are all concerned. Many of them, and the majority, have probably borrowed, and you know they are now faced with VAT levels potentially returning to 20%. A very sort of business rate relief, whilst welcomed, is relatively low by comparison in terms of financial sort of benefit. Plus, on top of that, you know, no cash through the tills or limited trade through the tills, low cash reserves. What we do know, and I believe the banks have actually told us, that there are many who have actually borrowed and possibly have bounce back loans that are sitting on deposit at the moment, just as a sort of, I think, a last gasp, because they are still concerned about how do they service that debt going forward, and if business doesn't return. So, you know, it's right across the spectrum. And that is why I go back to the points where, you know, I made in my opening comments around the importance of having, you know, favourable financing conditions for servicing debt and enabling that investment, so Scotland stays competitive against our competing destinations, and a supportive fiscal policy with proportionate legislation that doesn't put any additional cost onto business or onto the sector to allow it to recover over the coming 12 to 18 months and have a very strong spring, summer and autumn trading period. Thank you.
Just a couple of points on what you've been saying there. It's probably worth noting that for non-domestic rates, and you touched on rate relief there, and you seemed to indicate it wasn't tremendously beneficial in some ways, but in total, since 1st April 2020, businesses, not just in tourism and hospitality, have actually saved 1.6 billion in rates, which is not inconsiderable. It's a fairly large sum. The other thing is I'd like to explore more about debt levels and you mentioning that the bounce back loans don't seem to be, well, if they've been drawn down, they haven't spent it because they're afraid of repayments. Now, this is something we've heard in previous evidence before, and I just wondered the extent to which this is an issue.
I would say first to your first point around the rates relief, nobody is going to say or would disagree that any rates relief that the sector has received has been unwelcomed, and whatever we get in the future is exceptionally welcome. 2020, we had no trade at all in 2020. We had very limited trading opportunity in 2021. The burn rate, as an example, of a medium to large hotel per day is around £25,000 in some quarters, and much higher, but it's all proportionate to the size of business and the size of rates relief that they've got. So yes, very welcomed, but actually, you know, to maintain the basic overhead of a business, just to sit there with the lights on or lights off and no customers is exceptionally high. And again, they are part of Scotland's assets, and that's what draws people to come and spend their money here. The bounce back loans, I could say that, you know, I can't quantify how many businesses have done that. There is a huge number of businesses who have taken those loans, not just bounce back loans, but Siebel's loans too, and invested in their asset already, and have also had to spend that money using it to service debts and you know, help pay some of their overhead. Furlough was not a free ticket for anyone, and obviously trying to retain staff was came at a cost to business, and that cost gradually grew over the course of the COVID place. So those that have, you know, it's on deposit, but it won't be, given the size of overhead that a business has to service to be competitive and reopen in March as well. Many of them will reopen in March. You know, that comes at a cost. It doesn't just, you can't just switch on the lights without having to spend a fair bit of money on basic maintenance and ensuring that they are, you know, safe and well equipped to receive the guests in the summer season. So whatever money is there will go very quickly, I'm sure. But I'm not by any means saying that the majority have actually tucked away money into a reserve account for a rainy day when that might come. Quite the opposite.
I come to Stephen Montgomery, but I'd like to ask a slightly different question, different angle on this. How well have businesses been supported by Visit Scotland and the wider enterprise and skills agencies? Are there any lessons to be learned from that experience?
I think it's a bit of a difficult question to ask that, but thank you for it. I think Visit Scotland have done everything they can, and through the STA and Mark and his team, you know, and Visit Scotland, they've done everything possible. But with the variant and everything we've gone through in the last 20 months being so changeable, and we face different things every week, I think it's hard to actually, at the moment, or during the last 20 months certainly, path away through this, because we were constantly put down with restrictions, or we were coming out of restrictions, we were going back into restrictions. So I think it's a hard one really to answer there, Deputy Convener, but I think maybe Mark would be better placed to do that, because I'm not involved with the STA. However, when you're talking about debt levels, sorry to go back on that, I can give you some specifics on that. The average small to medium-sized pub is in between £80,000 to £85,000 debt. Nightclubs, £160,000 to £175,000 debt. Bounce back loans, a lot of limited companies would have took bounce back loans and used them for the service debt, or actually live on as well, because directors got absolutely nothing for support, where self-employed people got, you know, their tax back, etc. And if you look at the Scottish Hospitality Group alone, when Mark was referring to furlough not being a free ticket, that's absolutely right. Across our membership, £196,000 per week we were paying out on tax, national insurance and pension contributions to keep the furlough scheme alive. So that gives you some background on that. And on my own business here, between 2019 and 2021 accounts, we're 42% down, so that's £462,000 on a £1.1 million turnover. So that's a big drop in sales, and that's going to be a long way to recovery.
To make some progress, Deputy Convener. Okay. Apologies. Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Good morning, everybody. Apologies, I'm remote, but I hope you can hear me okay. I just wanted to ask a couple of general questions. The committee continues to be interested in how women specifically have been affected by the pandemic in your sector. So I've got a couple of general questions, which I'll just take an answer from you all. So, one, do you routinely disaggregate data so that you're collecting about the specific impact on women? And two, what are your observations against how they've been affected? And what thoughts do you have about how that could be rectified? So perhaps, Mark, you might like to go first with those general questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the question. Our industry is probably one of the most diverse and inclusive industries out there. And just referring back to the tourism and hospitality programme I referenced around the online learning piece, actually the greater majority of participants on that programme are actually women. It's the highest majority, and we've got some fantastic female leaders in our industry. We have a great body called Women in Tourism that are absolutely integrated into our networks and right across the country. And you know, my own team are all women, and I couldn't do without them. So clearly, as we've alluded to earlier, around the need to look inwards at our businesses of how can we be more flexible with working hours and attract more talent in of all diversities as well and age groups, you know, balancing home lifestyles, which again have become a new thing for a lot of us, how kids have had to learn at home, and there's a lot more sort of you know, opportunity to work from home. That very much opens up, you know, more career opportunities across all levels of the businesses to men and women. But you know, right now I stand very proud and can say, I think, and many of us and the men on the call, my colleagues will say the same. The women in our industry are very much part of our industry, and there are some great leaders. And you know, Kate Nichols, who's the chief executive of UK Hospitality, Emma McClarkin, who heads up the Beer and Pub, the UK Beer and Pub Association. There are many, you know, female leaders around the UK Tourism Industry Council as well. So, but it's important that we still continue to make sure that those adjustments in our ways of working can actually open up the door more and be more flexible. The mental health piece as well, I think, was touched on earlier. And again, that's not just for the women in the industry, it's the wider workforce, and the industry have taken ownership of that. And we've got some great, you know, sort of mental health wellbeing programs, which have been, again, supported and helped along by Scottish Government funding to deliver that support to everybody. But I understand the question, but I can stand tall and believe that, you know, women in our industry are very much part and parcel of, and a big part and important part of the sector. Thank you.
And thank you for that. But Mark, before we move on, do you have hard data in terms of women-led businesses, and do you routinely disaggregate that data in any surveys, for example, you do? Because I mean, I'm heartened by the warm, fuzzy feeling I'm getting from you, but data is everything. So yeah, do you have any hard data?
I personally don't have it, but I would be reasonably confident to think that Women in Tourism, which are an established group, do have that data. Skills Development Scotland obviously collect that survey data on a regular basis around mix. Yes, you know, it is something that we review, and not just by sex, but by age group as well, and obviously where the geography sits too. And you know, again, it comes back to some of the point I referenced earlier around transport infrastructure, housing, and all of those key important ingredients of having the right backup in destinations, particularly in rural communities, to attract couples and families to settle in those areas to ultimately work in the industry as well. But I can speak to my colleague Susan Russell, who's the chair of Women in Tourism, and bring that data forward for you, I'm sure, and as well as Lawrence Durden of Skills Development Scotland.
Thank you, and Stephen and Leon, in no particular order, the answer to the same question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the question. I absolutely back Mark up and everything he just said there. If you take up my own business here, we have 42 members of staff, and 34 of those are female. And I couldn't do it without them. I really couldn't. And they have certainly supported me throughout this pandemic, and I thank them for that. And as Mark said, we've got some really great ambassadors throughout tourism in Scotland and in the UK as a whole, as Mark alluded to there, Emma McClarkin and Kate Nichols, who have done fantastically. And I would stand by any agenda that was put forward to promote the females in hospitality, which is predominantly a female environment as well. And I would think every hospitality business will open, or work an open door policy you know, where they have female mentors or whatever the case may be. And I, as I said before, I totally agree with what Marcus just said.
And is it the case then, Stephen, that given the high proportion of women already in tourism and hospitality, that in fact you were already well versed with some of the flexible working that we've now seen come forward for other sectors? By their very nature, often women are juggling multiple elements in their lives. Is that true to say that?
Yeah, I think it would be fairly true, yes. And I think hospitality, as Marcus said there, is we are very, very flexible, and especially with, you know, where you have the older times where, you know, males have been out working or whatever, and you know, females have been at home maybe looking after kids, whatever the case may be. That has all changed. You know, that has all changed. And, you know, as we've seen over the last 20 months, we've had, you know, work from home, schooling from home, all that kind of thing. And businesses have had to adjust to that. And I think that's been a really positive move, which has opened up everything for us to make it that we have got to do that now, because we're not through this yet. We won't be until 2024, 2025 at the earliest. So we've got to embrace flexible working. We've got to embrace the mental health, the well-being, all that kind of thing of our employees. And if that is by promoting our female staff or whatever gender staff are, that is the way we will go. And I would stand by any agenda to promote that.
OK, and thank Leon, just to finish off, and then thank you, Steve.
OK, thank you. Thank you. I mean, just to echo what colleagues have already said, I mean, hospitality is certainly one of the most gender balanced sectors, I believe, that we have in the country. And obviously, my chief executive has been name checked, so I should certainly want to highlight the great work that Kate has done, not just for UK hospitality, but for the sector as a whole. I think, you know, we can't be complacent about the impact that this has had on our women workers. We know that a lot of people have exited hospitality, and we do need to understand, you know, the gender split within that as well. I can't give you any data on that. It may be that I can come back to the committee with something which might be helpful, and we're actually in the process of running a benchmarking survey at the moment as well. So I'll take a look at sort of, you know, how that's rolling out and the questions which are being asked in there around gender as well. That'll give a sort of UK-wide picture on what's happening. But, you know, I think it's important that we recognise the challenges that women have experienced over the course of the pandemic. You know, juggling home life, challenges around work or furlough, you know, cost pressures and so on. And I think as employers, businesses are good at looking at flexibility around shift patterns. I mean, that is something which businesses will have to become better at as well in order to attract and retain talent. So that's going to be a key feature of what happens. And I think we should probably also be looking at women returner programmes as well, so we can actually start encouraging the women to come back into hospitality, the women who have left the sector. But this all obviously chimes in with Fair Work, and I think that, you know, flexibility is going to be absolutely key for all our employees, really, as we move towards recovery. Thanks.
Yeah, and thank you very much for that. And for any of the three of you that have some data, because of course we've got stats out that says that women-led businesses have decreased from 21% in 2017 down to 14% just now, and it may well be that this sector is slightly exceptional, and so it would be useful to know that and start to understand some of the themes. So thank you very much, convener.
Thank you. We are a bit pushed for time, and I have three members who still wish to come in with questions. If I could ask members and witnesses to be concise, that would be helpful. Jamie Hilcro-Johnson to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thanks, Kavina. Good morning to the panel. My question is one around kind of support and one around kind of rural economy side of it. The first one, if I can ask this to Mark and to then to Liam, is around kind of competitor funding and support. In the STUG meeting notes from the 21st of October, it highlighted that Ireland it will be receiving, or the tourism sector will be receiving, 288.5 million in support or promotion, etc., euros in 2022. And that's an increase of 67.6 million euros. which works out, I think the total fund works out around £240 million if you compare it. In the same year, Visit Scotland will be receiving around £49 million. And although there are other, obviously, areas that support the tourism sector, some of those areas, such as HIES budget and certainly local government budgets, are being squeezed as well. So can you, starting with Mark, could you give you an idea of, you know, where we sit with our support of our tourism sector compared to our kind of competitor nations?
A good question, Jamie, and thank you for that. Obviously, we would always like more money to do. I mean, the Visit Scotland budget is obviously 49 million, as you say, and it's thankfully that's been protected. It's not gone backwards. We are obviously, there are funds that have been distributed as well to destination groups through that Stoke Recovery Plan, which has enabled the destinations themselves to activate marketing campaigns over and above the national marketing campaign. The islands you refer to there, we saw some amazing exposure of our islands on the media programmes, documentaries and things, which were great. So there was a lot of, I suppose, secondary benefit that came through marketing activity. But, to be able to respond and deliver against our competitor set, you look at Ireland at the moment, the PGA golf show in Orlando, that was on last week, the delegation that the Irish government were funded and backed and sent out to Orlando to be there was far greater than Scotland's presence. And I think view of the sector is that we need to have a bigger presence at these international shows as a big Team Scotland place. And that comes at a cost. But to be able to be at the races and ahead of the game and, right up there with the leaders, because we are, a destination that has got huge appeal and demand, but we have to have presence. And therefore, I would encourage that there would be further commitment to funding to enable, additional upweighted and marketing activity, both at a national level and through the destination communities as well. Likewise in the sector groups, and again, another lady who's championing the outdoor adventure sector, Victoria Brooks of Wild Scotland, again, really promoting that proposition. And it would be wrong for me not to nod to other leaders in our industry, the Fiona Campbells and the Susan Morrisons and the Rebecca Brookses as well, but all who are, very much there to lead and promote Scotland. So more investment, yes. Are we on par with our competitors? I think we're probably slipping slightly behind, and we need to get back up and do more as much as we can to be ahead of the curve and be the world leader in 21st century tourism, which is the underpinning strapline of our national strategy, Outlook 2030.
Thank you. And Leon.
Yes, I mean, we're at a point where destinations are really ramping up their marketing and promotion as people begin to travel again. We're back into a very, very competitive environment, which was the case as we went into the pandemic as well. And, Scotland does very well through its National Tourism Organisation, very imaginative campaigns which resonate very, very well with visitors, whether domestic or international. And, we are blessed with great assets, which are, a wonderful draw for visitors. But, we can't be complacent. And I know that Visit Scotland will be well aware of this, that, the competing against new and emerging destinations as well as established destinations, people will have more options for travel this year. So it will be really important to make sure that we've got hard-hitting and compelling international marketing campaigns, as well as campaigns that resonate strongly with the domestic market too. This year we have our theme of Scotland Stories. I mean, there's some great ways that that can be exposed and exploited, and I'm sure that that's already happening. And we have Unboxed as well, which can deliver some great events, or will deliver some great events taking place right across Scotland as well. But issues around comparison of budget, that is always there. We would always wish that there was more money to market and promote Scotland. We are facing increased competition.
That's right. very much. I mean, looking on those headline figures, as I say, compared with Ireland, it's looking at five times the amount being spent in the tourism sector, which I can imagine, you know, with all of our assets and the like, does put us at some disadvantage. Can I ask quickly regards to the kind of rural side? We've talked about the impact, particularly in labour markets and the like, on that. One of the issues that's been raised is that if we have a more, if we do rely slightly more in the next few years on a domestic, a UK and Scottish market, they're more price sensitive perhaps than the international travellers. Now, given that some parts of Scotland are, let's say, harder to get to, I mean, certainly in the Highlands and Islands areas that Highlands and Islands areas I reach, how could that impact on you know, being able to encourage domestic tourists to visit the all the parts of Scotland that we kind of know and love? And also in terms of a rural, I suppose a more focused rural side, one of the big issues that obviously in the tourism sector at the moment has been around the introduction of short-term let licensing. That impacts a lot on guest houses and B&Bs, which weren't perhaps intended to be included. How does that impact as well? Maybe get your thoughts on that too. If I can start with Leon, as you're on screen at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I mean, you're absolutely right. Cost is going to be a major issue. Businesses are looking at how they can manage their costs and try and keep costs down for their customers, and who are obviously also facing inflation and rising costs on utility and also national insurance costs coming along as well. So people will be looking for value for money, holidays, breaks, and destinations. And I think Scotland can offer that. But we again need to be able to, you know, really sort of talk up the advantages and the great things that people can do while they come here to Scotland. Transport, you mentioned, I mean, you know, yes, there are issues for sort of people travelling, you know, ferry costs. In particular, perhaps, are off-putting for people who want to get to Ireland destinations. I mean, that is an area where, you know, there probably needs to be some work looked at in terms of how that can be made more competitive for visitors trying to get to our more rural destinations. I think that's. You know, these are challenges, but these are probably challenges that we're going to face right across the country as actually sort of as costs increase and how we sort of are able to promote Scotland as a competitive destination and at the same time offer a high level of service and a high level of experience as well. You asked about short-term lets. You know that obviously UK Hospitality Scotland took a slightly different position from our colleagues in the short-term let market. For my members, there was a real desire to arrive at a situation where there was a level playing field between accommodation providers and the growth of short-term lets in rural and in urban settings really put hotels at a competitive disadvantage. So the licensing scheme, we believe, will address some of that. There's also issues around provision of affordable accommodation as well. I mean, you'll be very well aware of those challenges in rural settings, but again, that also sort of applies to our cities as well, and the impact that that has on my members who are already struggling to recruit staff because people just can't find accommodation or aren't living in nearby areas. That's a major challenge. So we had a different view on the importance of short-term let legislation, and we believe that you know, we have arrived at a situation which you know, can you know, benefit you know, all accommodation providers. And the working group for short-term lets is meeting later today to look at guidance for businesses to sort of streamline the process for them as much as possible.
Okay, thanks, Leon. And Mark, briefly as well, please.
Thank you, Jamie. I mean, I think the point made about transport, Leon touched on ferry pricing. I think what's important is that we have ferries that actually are able to get from A to B on a frequent and consistent basis. And it's a well-documented challenge that CalMac have faced with a fleet that is in disrepair most of the time. And obviously, the uncertainty of whether or not the boat will run is one that's caused concern for many of the island community. But we need to be able to optimise the trips as well that can carry the demand into the island. So having that transport infrastructure, not just on sea, but also good to see that Scotland's Railway is also looking at tourism as a main driver of opportunity as well. So infrastructure critical. Going on to the short-term lets piece, obviously the STA's position had to be neutral on that because of our membership having differing views. However, where we can stand absolutely together on this, and it goes back to the rep point I made earlier, is that we have to have a means of being able to help and support a very clear and concise and equitable process of collection of that license, and not have a cumbersome and costly setup through the local authorities, who will no doubt find it really challenging to collect the license. And the industry, I know the organisations like the ASSC and the Bed and Breakfast Association are very up for supporting local authorities and helping keeping those costs to a minimum, but making sure that we have the licensing scheme in place that has been vetted, approved, and will go through. So, I think there's a willing to work in partnership, but actually what's concerning again is that we could have 32 variations on a theme and additional costs on top because of an under-resourcing in some local authority areas who could administer this programme. So I think Highland Council are probably the first out, going to be one of the first big movers, and there's a lot of properties to consider there. But I would urge everybody to work with the industry bodies who can support a smooth process in this and keep costs to a minimum.
Thanks, Mark.
I'll now bring in Fiona Hislop, who will be followed by Colin Smith, who will have the last question.
Thank you. I might point out that Ireland has received £920 million from the EU in Brexit compensation that gives flexibility. But I want to talk about the domestic budget. Mark Crothall has mentioned that the Visit Scotland budget has been protected. But I want to specifically, and maybe just for brevity of time, just come to Mark Crothall on this, ask out the Scottish Tourism Emergency Response Group's work. We were disappointed to see that the phase two funding from that group is not in the face of the budget, but the Cabinet Secretary did say that the door is not closed on phase two funding, and she's working with Visit Scotland, and she referred to amounts of £25 million resource and £24 million of capital. So I really want to ask, how hopeful are you that you might get the in-year funding for that programme? Are these levels of funding that you recognise? What are the key elements of priority? And also, when would the best timing of spend be, particularly for that international marketing, bearing in mind what we've heard about when we're likely to get pickup and recovery? Yeah. If we have time, I might ask Leon after that about the timing specifically, very briefly. But Mark, if you can maybe give me the views of the Scottish Tourism Alliance. I know you've been very involved in the recovery group.
Yeah, thank you very much for the question. Yes, I'm well aware of Kate Forbes's response to the committee at the last time. We continue to have that dialogue with STURG, and obviously the suite of recommendations that were put forward in its entirety are obviously very, very costly. Nobody can it's difficult to put a price tag on it. But the net zero agenda, of course, is one that as a country we obviously want to move towards, and that again is work that needs to continue. I referred to the importance of maintaining the initiatives like the observatory programme. They need to carry on, so that does need funding. It would be wrong for it just suddenly to come to a blunt stop at the end of this year. International is absolutely critical, and the window is really March to be able to drive the pipeline. If that money doesn't come forward quickly, what we've got is in the tour operator sector is a group of tour operators who were protected with grant support, targeted support to see them through. But again, going back, their employees were on furlough. We've now got a group of businesses who are the glue that will stick a lot of this together in terms of acquisition, build a pipeline for 23. They have no furlough to fall back on. Their human capital needs to be protected. and they need to get out there and be able to market. So, but that window, going back to the competitive market, we have to be able to be there quickly. So, you know, I know we've had some very good dialogue with the tourism minister, Ivan McKee, within the tour operator group, and we continue that. But I think Ms. Forbes is well aware of the need, and going back as well, the other priorities around workforce. So if we can tackle those two in the first instance and put the emphasis on that with funding, then we've got a chance. But if we miss the March window, again, we could be on the back foot for, you know, 2023 and beyond, and that would be a great shame.
Thank you. And just very briefly, Leon Thompson, if you can maybe talk about that window and if additional funding can be found for international marketing, what is the timeframe that would be desirable?
Yeah, I mean, I absolutely agree with Mark. I mean, you know, time is of the essence on this, and really, you know, March is the window. We need to have promotion running, spend taking place, you know, in order to attract international visitors. Start attracting international visitors from that point, because, you know, they're making their holiday plans right now and we need to catch them.
Thank you. Back to Camino.
Thank you, Ms. Hislop. Colin Smith.
Thank you very much indeed, convener, and good morning to the panel. Politicians are very good at not answering the question. You guys have managed to do something different by answering my question before I've asked it. But I will, and that was really, I suppose, to ask what additional support you think the Scottish Government should be doing next in terms of supporting the sectors. I'll give you a chance to very briefly highlight any issues you haven't already covered, obviously without duplicating what's been said. But I do have a second question for each of you, starting with Mark. A point that you've made a number of times is that some areas have been especially hit hardest during the pandemic. City centres, I think, was the one that you stressed, but maybe some of our rural areas and non-traditional tourism destinations have had a boost due to staycations in some what are very fragile economies. Your emphasis seems to be about getting people back into places they used to go to, but surely there's an argument if we're serious about building an inclusive economy, what we should be looking at is keeping those people that have gone to non-traditional tourism areas that have a very good offer, but simply haven't had visitor numbers like that in the past for purely historic reasons, not because of that offer. Surely that is an untapped opportunity to grow the sector rather than just simply going back to where we used to be.
Thank you very much. And the very much, you know, Scotland Outlook 2030, which was launched on the 4th of March 2020, I chaired the steering group, the First Minister stood with us on stage and launched it. The build of that strategy, which involved 3,500 industry colleagues and the government and the agencies, the emphasis is all about to spread tourism across Scotland, you know, and actually share the wealth. So, but that, you know, requires infrastructure investments and actually working with those communities and making sure that the offering is absolutely right. And the one thing that we've benefited from COVID is that we've seen many Scots actually explore more of parts of Scotland they never even knew existed, and, you know, hopefully they will be telling their stories in this year of stories to friends and colleagues elsewhere. But having that infrastructure in situ to be able to make sure that it's easy to get to, and actually people can transact online, and there are no sort of blips in the supply chain is going to be really important. Your other point around what else can be done. I mean, I should have touched on it earlier around grant support. I've raised it a few times on calls now with colleagues and officials. It's all about being flexible now as we recover from COVID, and we've got to work in partnership, industry, government, agencies together to get through this, and we have to be flexible. The grant funding that has been made available to businesses has been hugely welcomed, for example, the destination marketing funds. But because we've had this pause over the winter period and disruption, we've now got a situation where monies that have been awarded are actually needing, and under the budgetary compliance, having to be spent by the 31st of March. And there would be a lot of money probably in the system that is about to be committed or spent by the 31st of March. And with a bit of flexibility, and possibly that needs to obviously be up with my pay grade and yours, no doubt, and others, with the Audit Commission to say, look, we would get more ROI on this investment, and it would be better spent if it could be rolled over into the next fiscal year. So we're not trying to concentrate everything into what is now only a matter of weeks. And I know many colleagues in the industry are, you know, challenged by this, of actually even being able to deliver that activity in the time frame. So, and I'm sure Visit Scotland's budget, if there is anything over, we would rather be more flexible on spend as well, and allow us to recover in a strategic and timely way to get the best bang for the investments that's there.
Thanks for that. It's a very, very well made point, Matt. I'm sure the committee will pick that up. Thanks very much for that. Can I turn to Stephen and Leon and give you also a chance, I suppose, to briefly give us any final ask, but can I also ask about how we can help hospitality, I suppose, to coin a phrase, live with COVID, as in some form it's likely to be with us for some time to come. When I was having, what I have to say was a very good family meal at your hotel in Lockerbie, Stephen, on Boxing Day, I was struck by a point you made. That you hadn't gone ahead with your usual Christmas Day opening because you were very uncertain about where the government were going with restrictions, and you didn't want to have to cancel everything at the last minute. Is there anything the government needs to do when it comes to a future COVID framework that would help the hospitality sector have a bit more certainty when it comes to any response that we have to make to the pandemic in the future? I'll start with Stephen, then maybe come the same point to Leon, sorry.
Yeah, absolutely, Colin. Thank you very much for the question. And I'd like to say thanks very much. I hope I'm glad you enjoyed your Boxing Day. I think one thing I would say, well, two things really, proper consultation. Don't expect us just to flick a switch and be able to adapt to change. Hospitality, albeit diverse, it's not just something we can change overnight. Planning, preparation and execution, that is the key to any success. And we just can't have an execution and everybody then fumbling around trying to plan and prepare. We live in a really lovely part of Scotland, down in Dumfries and Galloway here. But my view is we're always the forgotten part of Scotland. If you take it, it's a main route, the A75, from Dunark and Ryan through to Europe. And if you look at the state of the road, and I know it's maybe digressed a wee bit, but if you're talking about connectivity and the way we get to places, we need to have a look at that to drive people into Dumfries and Galloway. We're lucky now to be able to have a national park going to be hopefully coming here. But to dual that, A75 would be absolutely key to driving people into Dumfries and Galloway. But going forward, as Mark said, flexible support is key. But I still go back to that same three things: planning, preparation, execution. They give us a proper framework and more consultation with the sector.
And the same point to Leon about that future framework.
Yes, thank you. So very quickly, consultation and having a strong partnership between the sector and government is going to be absolutely key going forward. I think in the framework, we also really need to see more trust being displayed by government in hospitality to do the right thing and to keep workforce and customers safe. Businesses have shown time and time again that we'll go beyond the baseline measures in place in order to restore consumer confidence and make sure that everybody is enjoying themselves in a safe way, in a safe environment. So I think it's that that element of trust needs to be kind of built in somewhere into the framework as well. And just on that point of flexibility, you know, we don't know what is going to be ahead of us. But what we do need is a framework which can adapt and ideally can ensure that businesses can stay open and trade as fully as possible. Thanks.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the three witnesses this morning for their contribution to our session. It's very much appreciated. We will now have a brief suspension while we change over the panel. May I now welcome our second panel to this morning's session, Rob Dixon, who's Director of Industry and Destination Development, and Vicky Miller, Director of Marketing and Digital, both from Visit Scotland. Again, can I ask members to keep their questions concise as well as panellists? So thank you for joining us this morning. Could I first ask about Visit Scotland's own budget? We did take evidence from Visit Scotland in the lead up to our budget discussions with the government. You had highlighted the difference in grant aid allocation, that there's been an understandable decrease in 22-23, but this left a gap between what the expectation would be for in grant and aid allocation. Can you maybe say a bit about how Visit Scotland are preparing to manage the budget for this coming year and what challenges they're facing? And I do understand that the Scottish Government has secured the ongoing budget, but there's issues with the budget that's been raised from marketing. So could I ask who would be... Rob, do you like to respond to that first question?
Yes, I'm quite happy to start, and thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to talk to you this morning. I think the Visit Scotland budget, like many national agencies, has seen over the last two or three years some very unusual changes because of the way that the grant funding has played through for distribution. So perhaps the fair comparison is to look pre-COVID at where we were and where we're going to be from April this year. So our budget in headline terms is returning to pre-COVID levels. That presents, I think, some challenges for us because, of course, we're still trying to support the tourism sector through recovery. And the elements of what we need to do to ensure that that recovery piece is successful would be different, fundamentally different, to where we were in pre-COVID times. That said, we will return to more of our core activity. The support that we provide for the tourism sector, particularly the individual businesses, particularly the destination management organisations and sectors, in that effort to support recovery. And that's an opportunity for us to deploy our resources in a prioritised way that begins to focus more on Outlook 2030 than the position has been for the last 2 years in respect of responding quite rightly to the challenges presented by COVID. Much of the resource in Business Scotland over the last 2 years has been deployed to distribute grants. That's not a core business activity for Visit Scotland. It's been an essential activity in the last 2 years. It continues today as of the year, but we're optimistic that in 2022-23 we'll have the opportunity to return more to our core activity, but with an emphasis on supporting recovery towards Outlook 2030. And I think maybe on the marketing point, Vicky might want to pick up.
Okay. Could you maybe talk about, the replacing the self-generated income, which I understand was 6 million in 2019-20. That usually would sit about 14 million. And do you have expectations on when that budget is likely to recover?
It's probably easier for me to pick up. So the two areas that predominantly provide that income are around eye centres and tourist information centres and our quality assurance scheme. So the income levels defray the costs that we incur and the provision of those services. Now, clearly, in the past 2 years, the income has been much, much reduced, inevitably, but so have the costs, because, as I outlined a moment or two ago, much of our resource has been deployed in grant distribution. As we move forward through 2022, we'll need to ensure that we balance the ability to raise the income to continue to defray the costs required, utilising the grant that we get effectively as well. I think we will see in the course of 22-23 both of our quality assurance scheme and our eye centres moving into a more normal way of operating. We expect to see the income levels begin to rise. I think it's probably unlikely that they'll return to pre-COVID levels in the course of 22-23. I think it might take another further year or perhaps even two, but we'll need to make sure that we manage the costs of providing those services in a way which ensures we balance the books at the end of the year. That's always the approach that's taken. I think it'll just require a little bit more care in the next 12 to 24 months to make sure that, the balance between the grant aid available and the income that we're able to generate is taken into account effectively.
That's helpful. Thank you. I'll now bring in Colin Smith to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. Just building on that point, and good morning to the panel. In the previous session, Mark Crawford from STA made the point that it would help businesses and probably Visit Scotland if there was flexibility on when grants and indeed budgets had to be spent. So there's an expectation that it has to be done by the 31st of March. Do you have any comment on the point that Mark was making there? Would it help Visit Scotland? Would it help those businesses that you've been providing grant funding to if there was that flexibility to, you know, as we head towards, I suppose, the end of that financial year? I'm not sure who wishes to grab that one with both hands. I'll leave it to you to decide.
I'll let Rob answer that one. I'll come back on marketing later.
Thank you, Colin. It's good to see you again. Position in the public sector is well understood that the 31st of March presents every year a challenge in respect of utilisation of funds. I think this year it's particularly challenging. It's probably the most challenging that I've experienced in my career, certainly, because of the impact of Omicron around what would always be a particularly focused time of the year in December and January. The financial rules are the financial rules, and expenditure has to be concluded by the 31st of March. Were flexibility to be available, then of course it would be welcome, but I well understand that the rules are in place across the whole of the UK are for reasons of prudent management of public finances, and you know, we'll need to balance the requirements to match those rules with our ability to spend effectively in the next 8 weeks, and crucially helping and supporting businesses to spend in the next 8 weeks with the funding that's available for them, and we're very focused on that across the funds that we are managing and operating at present.
Thanks very much indeed for that, Rob. Can I just pick on one final point that was made also by Mark and others, and that was that a number of areas have been hit particularly hard as a result of the pandemic. So city centres, in terms of visitor numbers and hospitality, were highlighted, but actually maybe non-traditional tourism destinations in some rural areas saw a boost due to staycations, and arguably they have fragile economies, and in all the economic indicators are probably lagging behind cities. The stress seems to be on how do we get people back to where they used to go. But surely there's an argument, and you'll know exactly the areas I'm talking about, Rob. There's an argument that says, well, there are non-traditional tourism areas that have huge potential and for purely historic reasons haven't had the same level of visitor numbers than maybe other areas. And what your strategy should be about is trying to get people to stay in those non-traditional areas or come back to those non-traditional areas because that's got real potential to grow the overall tourism market in Scotland. I suppose I'll start with Rob because you're on my screen, Rob, but then obviously Vicky, I'm sure, want to come in around how we market those areas.
Happy to.
Thank you. Yes, I agree entirely with the comments that you've made, and I agree with Mark's response to your comments earlier on. We will not grow tourism in Scotland if we continue to focus on the areas that have always been focused on. Setting aside the impacts of the pandemic for the moment, the crucial challenge of Outlook 2030, the tourism strategy that's in place in Scotland for this decade, is about spreading tourism more widely and fulfilling the unfulfilled potential of many parts of Scotland. And you're right to highlight that has perhaps been one of the unforeseen benefits of COVID, and particularly rural locations. But we need to ensure that we maximise the opportunity to sustain the visitor numbers in those areas, but also then seek to ensure that other parts of Scotland that are less well visited, that have the potential to host more visitors, to boost their local economy because of the great benefit that tourism brings to the economy, we've got to pursue that. Now, that in the short term has to be set against recovery, and I wouldn't wish anyone to think that Visit Scotland isn't focused on the need to support recovery in the cities as well as in many other parts of Scotland. But we've got to transition from a response to COVID to the recovery from COVID and onwards to our ambition in Outlook 2030. But in terms of what you said about potential of particularly rural areas, that's part of what we need to focus on in Outlook 2030, and it's certainly at the forefront of our thinking.
Thank you for the question and good morning, everyone. I would absolutely agree with what Rob's just said there. A key focus of our marketing strategy has always been to promote seasonal and regional spread, so really to kind of add value and make sure that we are spreading visitors, that we're promoting the hidden gems. And that's a big part of our recovery approach with a very much a responsible tourism focus in mind. To do that, we have got to be agile, though. We've got to look at, if we're going to see short-term recovery, we've got to be very agile. We've got to use kind of data and insight, both from the industry in Scotland, but also what we're seeing in terms of consumer behaviour, to make sure that we're getting to those first returning visitors and directing them to the kind of experiences that they are looking for, while at the same time, we're investing strategically for the medium to long term, kind of really build awareness of Scotland and some of those unique experiences that are less well known in the areas that are less well known. And that will take time and, I guess, investment over the long term. And I think going back to the earlier question on marketing, January to March is always an optimal window. People are planning for their holiday, but actually we need a year-round approach to marketing. And something that Visit Scotland, and certainly I believe, is that, and over the course of this pandemic we have done, is to keep Scotland present in the minds of our consumers in all of our key markets, even when that's been with a Dream Now travel later message, because we need those first returning visitors to be thinking about Scotland. So that will be very important in terms of short term, with that strategic approach around the kind of medium to long term. What will also be important, I guess, from a marketing perspective, though, is investment in the marketing ongoing, but also restoring connectivity internationally. That will be key, and getting back to the kind of frequency of routes that we saw in 2019. That will be really important, and continue to invest in the product.
That's me, convener. I'll look forward to a repeat of that very good South Scotland campaign that you had a couple of years ago sometime soon. Thanks.
Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Thanks very much, convener, and well, morning to the panel. We obviously need the tourist industry to bounce back as quickly as possible, given its importance to the Scottish economy. And to continue the earlier discussion on labour shortages, we've got hotel occupancy levels that are low, partially because many hotels don't have the staff to service all the rooms. And we've got many restaurants that are closed at lunchtime or are closed a couple of days a week, again, due to staff shortages. Paraphrasing the comment you just made a second ago, Rob, we can't grow tourism in Scotland if there's a labour shortage. So how do we address the 40,000 hospitality job vacancies we have, and when we are at full employment in Scotland?
I think thank you for the question. I think the panel in the previous discussion covered this in some detail and were very accurate in what they said. There were pre-COVID challenges in terms of the labour market. COVID and the slightly longer period post-Brexit now have, I think, probably accentuated those challenges. The critical point from a Visit Scotland perspective is to make sure that the national programmes fit for the tourism sector as best as we can make them. So Skills Development Scotland clearly lead in this area in terms of labour market challenges in Scotland. What we've sought to do through the STURG response is to make sure that the tourism sector piece is well understood by Skills Development Scotland and the programmes that they have in place, some of which we're very fortunate to have been funded through STURG in the past 12 to 18 months, are as effective as is possible. The forward look on this is very, very challenging. The National Records for Scotland prognosis about Scotland's population that was published in mid-January I think spells out very, very clearly the need for a sustained and long-term effort on this. We are not going to resolve the labour challenges in a matter of weeks or months. We're going to have to take a much more systematic view about career opportunities. And businesses need to understand where labour is essential, where digital efficiency plays its part, and where overall business efficiency plays its part. Because we need to make sure that the people we employ enjoy their work, are well rewarded through that Fair Work agenda for their work, and see their future in tourism as one that is challenging and enjoyable, but gives them a successful career across all parts of Scotland. You know, tourism has to compete with other sectors in Scotland and beyond to attract people, and I think that's a significant challenge for us. But I would not wish to shy away from the long-term challenge that is presented here and the demographic challenges that we face in terms of working age population in Scotland generally. But these are extreme challenges in some parts of Scotland, particularly rural parts, and it will hinder economic development generally, but tourism as well. And I think it would be, we need to have a well-coordinated, long-term public sector response to this that ensures year on year we're making the difference that needs to be made for our working age population.
And given the demographic challenges that you highlighted that we've got, would you be supportive of the calls for either a hospitality visa or devolving the immigration system?
They're not issues that Visit Scotland's really focused on. Those are parts of the wider picture. I mean, I think there's a wide range of issues that can play their part. These may be part of the resolution, but I think it is crucially important we understand how each of these elements complements each other and what part they can play. If they are the right things to do and the industry believes that, then yes, I'm sure Visit Scotland would be supportive of them. However, I think we need to be certain that we've got long-term solutions in play here and they can each play a valuable part in what we do.
Okay, thanks very much, Camilla.
Thank you. Jamie Howell, Crowe Johnson, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much. Good morning to you both. Can I just ask, Rob, you mentioned that budgets are back to pre-pandemic levels. In 2018-19, the budget was 50 million, 2019-20, nearly 60 million. It's now down to 49 million. So it looks like a reduction and it's obviously been cut this year. Given that, as we looked at some of, you know, one of our competitor nations in terms of Ireland has increased its spending by, I think it was 67 million euros, increased it by that amount, which is greater than the total budget for Visit Scotland. How does that impact on your ability to promote tourism and support it across country and, as I say, promote it internationally?
Rob, do you want me to pick this one up?
Yeah, I think so, Vicky.
I think there will be, looking at the budget figures you mentioned, there will be an element of ring-fenced budget in those numbers, which is possibly where the you know, you're seeing that discrepancy. What I would say on the marketing side, yeah, absolutely no doubt that, you know, Ireland has significant budgets and they are indeed a competitor. The offer, I guess, in terms of that outdoor product is very similar. I would argue that Scotland has a better proposition. It certainly means that we need to be more smart with our targeting. And it means we need to work collaboratively as Team Scotland. And our activity needs to be not just direct to the consumer, but also actually working with, particularly internationally, if we want to grow our share of outbound tourism. And that's where there is a huge opportunity, because Scotland's share of outbound tourism in some of our key markets is less than 1%. So the opportunity to grow that, even by a small amount, would make a significant difference to the Scottish economy. And so through consumer marketing is one way we can do that, with very smart targeting. So getting to the audiences that have the right fit for Scotland and getting to the audiences that are in the market to travel now will be particularly important for short term. But what Visit Scotland has also put in place is market specialist teams. who work very closely with the international travel trade to educate them on the Scottish product and to get them selling Scotland. So, for example, this year we will have undertaken over 40, albeit virtual in normal times, these would be in-market events, face-to-face with travel trade, including connecting businesses with those tour operators to get them selling Scotland and increasing the number of Scotland programmes that are for sale through travel intermediaries. We've also been involved in delivering over 5,000 training sessions with travel agents right across the globe. So that business-to-business strategy is very important. We also have an in-house PR team. They are also split into markets and market specialists. So through earned opportunities, capitalising on events, capitalising on film and TV in our key markets, and through indeed working with Team Scotland SDI, are kind of activating our global networks to do a really good advocacy job for us. Okay. So it's about being really smart with the resources that we have, being very targeted where we are, targeting directly the consumer with our marketing. But it's also that expert resource that we've invested in that means that we can, I guess, punch above our weight and extend our reach. But there is absolutely no doubt that investing in more marketing to grow our share of global outbound travel would make a huge difference, particularly because of the share that we have at the moment and the low awareness that we have in some markets.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I imagine that our competitors will be saying that they'll be doing innovative and new ways as well. So while I appreciate that and I welcome that, as I say, there is a big discrepancy in the budgets. Very quickly, could I ask Rob, you talked about investment in rural areas, and I think Vicky as well mentioned, making sure that that we look some areas that perhaps, promoting responsible tourism, we looked at areas where we can kind of increase tourism. There is huge pressure in some of our most rural, in our most remote and rural areas in terms of tourism infrastructure. That is not going to be helped by budgets being cut for local councils as well, that might be putting in some of that infrastructure, such as toilets and better road infrastructure. So how do we do that? How do we increase tourism to that area if that's what we're looking to do, while also making sure that that infrastructure is in place? This is a big issue in some of the islands. It's a big issue on Skye, big issue around North Coast 500.
Yeah, and I think Visit Scotland has, by utilising the government funds and the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, responded to exactly that pressure in recent years. There's now 4 years of rural tourism infrastructure funding. In the course of the pandemic, one of the things that we've been able to do is to support councils in developing infrastructure, strategic infrastructure plans, which we hope will develop a more solid pipeline for applications to the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund. And we genuinely believe that that fund and the scope and way that it operates is a very, very effective response to the challenges that you highlight. Crucially, what it allows councils to do is to work with private sector, communities, other interests in providing the infrastructure, both to deal with the pressure points, but also where it's most needed in terms of the potential of increasing tourism in certain areas. So I think continuing to support the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, making sure that we provide behind-the-scenes support to councils and businesses in how that can best be accessed is crucially important in responding to the very clear pressure that you identify.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, both Rob and Vicky. Thank you for joining us this morning. We heard this morning in the earlier panel about the entrepreneurship, the diversification, and the sort of innovation that's happening across across tourism to create post-COVID and post-recovery what will probably look like a very different industry, a very different sector than pre-COVID. One of the things that's clear, international experts say, recovery won't happen for at least another two, full recovery won't happen for at least another 2 years. And in the comments we've already heard this morning, there's that tension, I think, between trying to go back to what we had, because we knew that, and the comments that you've already made about making sure we make the most of seasonal and regional spread. But there's something in here for me around long-term resilience and sustainability. And there's a lot of focus on long-haul flights. There's a lot of focus on bringing more people into Scotland. And with rising fuel costs, with rising air travel costs that we are likely to see, and and people may be moving away from that because of the climate emergency, is there work that we need to be doing to make tourism more sustainable in all senses? How people arrive here, how people with lower incomes, especially perhaps families, can afford to take part in the activities, how accessible destinations are, different models of ownership, how costs can be met from smaller spends, but more smaller spends. Can you say just a little bit about the sort of longer term sustainability that we need to be thinking of, given both the changes we know will be happening in aviation and the diversification entrepreneurship that we've heard about? Thanks. Rob, do you want to start, and then Vicky?
Yeah, maybe on the international and the aviation end. So Visit Scotland's focus on responsible tourism is growing by the day and by the week. And I think we recognise the challenge that the transition to net zero presents to the tourism sector in Scotland. I mean, I think it's very clear, and I think Mark touched on this in the previous conversation, that businesses are hugely challenged by this agenda, but hugely challenged by the competing pressures of recovery from COVID and addressing this agenda. It follows that for Visit Scotland, we must get the short and the medium term priorities in a proper sequence here in order to best support business. And I think the work that was done through STIRG and the way that funding was provided through STIRG, which balanced both business support requirements against destination net zero programmes, was the right way to go about it. So on the one hand, we need to make sure that businesses, in a true business sense, are as effective as they can be, as competitive as they can be, that their digital offer, particularly to international visitors, but also for domestic, are as strong as possible. And that's a huge focus for us in terms of the business support we provide. But we also need to be providing the best support we can in respect of that transition to net zero. What does that mean for businesses that are building based? What does it mean for businesses that are more outdoor focused? Transport is a common theme there. I think the challenge in Scotland, which is presented in terms of how we move people around Scotland, how public as best as it possibly can, the demands of tourists as well as domestic travellers, are all significant issues. These were recognised as significant issues 2 years ago, pre-COVID, when Outlook 2030, the strategic vision for tourism in Scotland was launched. I think probably what has happened in the course of the last 2 years is that we've rightly had to focus on the COVID response. We need to pick up and reprioritise the focus on net zero in order to make sure that that transition takes place. Arguably, if we're going to hit the 2030 targets, not over the 10 years that we'd hoped for, but over the 8 remaining years that are left. So I would re-emphasise what I said earlier, the response needs to move to recovery. The recovery needs to look to the 2030 focus. Destination net zero needs to come to the fore in the business support that we provide. But I would be clear that we're already doing that through, for example, the STIRG work that's providing EV charging grants to more rural businesses, certification for businesses in terms of their energy consumption, climate change target attainment. And these sorts of very practical tools will be helpful in the years ahead.
Thank you, Rob. Vicky, do you have comments to add?
Thank you. And yeah, thank you for the question. I think going back to maybe what we've already touched on, absolutely we'll need a balance of visitors, both domestically and internationally, for a sustainable recovery to achieve our objectives of seasonal and regional spread. UK market, really, really important for that all year round visitation. More of a short break market. The opportunity there is obviously to encourage people to take from the UK to take longer holidays in Scotland. And I think post pandemic, we're in a very good place to do that because we have exactly what you mentioned the family market are looking for. You know, it's lots of fresh air, it's outdoor, it's connection with nature. And so working with the sectors, it's about looking at how we are agile to kind of adapting the offer to meet the different insight that we are seeing from the different audiences that are looking to travel. We're also seeing a younger visitor more interested in Scotland, and particularly enjoying you know, more adrenaline-fueled activities. And we've got a real strong sector there in terms of, you know, outdoor activity operators that I think have really been leading the way in terms of offering new experiences. It's unique experiences that our visitors are looking for. And so keeping that focus on, as Rob said, supporting the industry to adapt their offer aligned to the consumer trend will be really important. Going back to international, 20% of the volume pre-pandemic, but 44% of the actual spend. American visitors spend four times more than a domestic visitor, you know, did. European visitors will spend something in the order of twice, double what a domestic visitor will spend. If I take core markets like France and Germany, they're also really important for regional and seasonal spread. They will also come back to Scotland more than once. And so we have a huge opportunity there to get them to do the places, to visit the places they've never been, so and to inspire them to kind of travel further and equally do more. American market and some of our other long haul, probably more first time visitors, but the opportunity there is to work with the likes of the tour operators and you know, the travel intermediaries internationally, to kind of really show the other side of Scotland as well and the things that are off the beaten track, and help them to build product itineraries with the industry in Scotland and promote these lesser known areas. Because again, we're seeing some very similar consumer interest in the North American market, from getting off the beaten track, being outdoors, well-being, etc. So again, we're very well placed, I think, to kind of pivot and focus our offer to take advantage of these consumer trends.
Thank you.
It's about capitalising on data and insight.
Thanks very much for that, Vicky. Thanks.
Thank you. I'll now take Colin Beattie to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to explore a little bit more around competitiveness. And I know various members have touched on elements of this. I mean, every destination across the globe has been impacted by COVID-19, and they're all trying to build back their businesses. And they're all investing heavily. I mean, Ireland's been highlighted at spending 288.5 million euros in tourism this year. Of course, Ireland benefits from the Brexit compensation fund, which gives it 920 million euros. So that's a nice sum of money to be able to work on. And we certainly don't have access to anything like that. Being competitive is obviously of vital importance to the economy. If we're not competitive, then our industries will go down, the economy will shrink, and we'll all be poorer. So it's really something incredibly important. If we just measure it in money, it seems quite difficult for us to be competitive. But do we measure competitiveness only in money, or are there other things that we can do more clever to compensate for the fact that we just don't have the sort of cash that other countries are pouring into it? Maybe Rob, you could start off there.
Yeah, I'm happy to. I'm sure Vicky will pick up as well on it. I think Vicky just touched a point about the experience in Scotland. I don't think anyone on the committee or at Visit Scotland would doubt that we have a product which can stand comparison with any other country in the world. The vision in Outlook 2030 to be the world leader of 21st century tourism is a very striking and ambitious vision, but it's one that I think the tourism sector was confident about putting in place back in 2020, and I think it remains confident, despite COVID, that it can aspire to that position. So our competitiveness has to be based on, for me, two critical things. Firstly, the experience that visitors have in Scotland. And that starts in the moment through the businesses that host them, the experiences they have, whether they're outdoor or visitor attractions or whatever they might be, accommodation providers, etc. The business support function that Visit Scotland provides, therefore, has to be very, very focused on constantly improving the efficiency and consequently the competitiveness financially of that business, but also in terms of the quality of the experience. So the staples in Visit Scotland's work over a long number of years have been about the quality of the experience and the efficiency of the business. And I think those are the two routes that lead most effectively to competitiveness. I responded to the previous question around the challenges of net zero. And of course, that also comes to the fore in our competitiveness in terms of what the consumer is looking for and what the consumer experiences. For Visit Scotland, we need to make sure that we're gathering the right data to respond to those pressures in a post-COVID era, as well as what we had in a pre-COVID era.
Talking about is basically word of mouth advertising, which is effective. But if other countries are hard selling their products with more money than we've got, how do we compensate for that? How do we, once you get people here, we can, you know, they have the experience and hopefully they will go out and spread the word. But you've got to get the people here first. And, you know, if you've got the more money you've got, the better chance you have to spread that word. Do we have enough money? Do we have enough resources to be able to do that in our target markets?
If I thank you for that question. If I put it in this way, for every pound we invest in marketing, we deliver £8 back to the Scottish economy. So the more we invest, absolutely, the greater the return, and it can be very immediate because our marketing is aimed at works at two levels. It works at that growing the awareness and the intent for Scotland, which is absolutely needed to grow our share of inbound tourism into Scotland. But it's also about driving immediacy in terms of bookings into the industry where it's needed most. So you get an immediate return on that investment. Where I think we have been very smart is that we have a Team Scotland approach. We do capitalise on our global networks, ancestral networks. If we look at SDI, our Global Scots network, we do a lot internationally by coming together, presenting Scotland on the global stage. Events like Scotland Week, for example, in New York are a great example of where we can do that. We can create a lot of noise over a short period of time by being present in the market with advertising at the time, but also running kind of a number of networking events and really using those Scots that are based out in Scotland to do a job for us. So we need to be smart. We need to use those global networks. I think we're very fortunate in that Visit Scotland has built up a significant social media reach, greater than any of the other UK nations, and probably we're up there with Australia in terms of the reach that we achieve every day through our social media channels. And that advocacy should not be underestimated because people are constantly sharing their kind of holiday memories and how great their Scottish experience was through those channels. And it's also capitalising on the global events that we host in Scotland. And I think, you know, that goes back to a point that was made earlier, that having events in Scotland is critical to being able to maximise the global media coverage that they realise. And working with the likes of, the International Film Festival and all of the other, you know, events that take place across Scotland gives us a unique opportunity to kind of harness those. But going back to your original question, yes, we can give a guaranteed return on investment, and therefore it can make a significant difference if we do invest in marketing.
I seem to recall from previous evidence sessions we've taken on the hospitality and tourism business that Ireland actually receives a multiple of the number of visitors that Scotland does. Now, that would seem to indicate that they're much more successful at attracting tourists in. Would you comment on that?
Ireland's numbers are similar to us. It's slightly higher in terms of international. Yes, I would agree. Again, they do benefit from having those kind of ancestral connections, particularly in North America. And I think it is North America where they have a bigger share of the outbound market than we do.
But we have a huge, or should have a huge reach in America as well. I remember standing in Ellis Island, pressing the buttons for where people of Scottish ancestry were, and there was over 20 million scattered across particularly the eastern seaboard. Surely that's something we should be capitalising on.
Absolutely. And I think what you will see coming up actually with this year's Scotland Week programme is a more ambitious programme of activity actually in the market and across the various agencies, Scottish Government, SDI, and ourselves, in terms of a programme of activity to kind of really raise that profile and take advantage of the opportunity that's likely to be also in person again this year.
One last question. How do you measure your competitiveness against other countries?
So we have a variety of insight, and obviously we are working towards a tourism observatory that will be able to analyse a variety of real-time information that we have, but also studies that are done with visitors directly kind of in market, and some of that does, you know, that benchmarking job, particularly around the actual quality of the visitor experience and the awareness of Scotland. So we've got a number of research sources. During the last 2 years of the pandemic, we have been running a UK and an international two trackers. We look at kind of sentiment within the UK market and internationally. And those studies have also delved into holiday taking habits, but also kind of propensity to visit Scotland, or indeed visitation to Scotland. So we have those rich sources of information, but we've also got wealth of real-time information through things like Google search trends, where we can benchmark and we can look at whether there's any shift in demand for Scotland. And again, we can do that through partnerships that we have with the likes of the OTAs and other travel intermediaries who share their data with us in terms of that kind of search and booking demand for Scotland and how it compares with other destinations. So a lot of rich sources of information, and one of the roles of the observatory will be to look at how we can pull all of that together and present it in a very visual way that's also useful not only to the agencies but to the industry themselves, to kind of help them plan, see the trends that are coming through in visitor behaviour, and the opportunities by market. So a number of different ways that we can benchmark.
Thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll bring in Michelle Thompson, but it might be interesting for us to find out as a committee. I know Ireland's been talked about quite a bit this morning. The percentage of tourism is to Ireland's GDP, which I suspect is higher than Scotland's, but that's something we can follow up with SPICE. Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Alexander Burnett.
Good morning and thank you, Convener. I just want to ask a couple of questions. I'm aware of time. First of all, in terms of the phase one projects, I'm aware two are at Amber Destination Net Zero and the Scottish Tourism Observatory. I just really, for the record, wanted to get a sense of the current status and rationale and any further thoughts about those before I go on to another question. So whoever is most appropriate is fine.
Yeah, happy to pick up on those. Yeah, I think it's fair to say they've both been impacted by just the what happened in and around December because of Omicron, so that they were placed at Amber just because of slight delays in the work. They're well on track now in terms of delivery, and indeed Destination Net Zero activity was launched just yesterday, I think, with further to follow this week. So we will deliver on those programmes, and I touched on the EV charging work earlier in the committee's conversations, and you know, it's great to see that opportunity for businesses to apply for grants and get support in installing EV charging on their properties. Likewise, on the energy certification scheme, which is also now up and running. On the observatory, that one has been more challenging. It's largely capital expenditure. We've had to plan in quite short timescales the work on that, and that's now underway. Companies appointed through procurement, and as Vicky indicated earlier, that's going to be an ongoing piece of work for us beyond the end of the 31st of March. So, you know, it's something that will be developed in the coming months, and I would hope years actually, and therefore it's a fundamental building block for our future that we're putting in place, not just a programme that's going to stop and start in the current financial year. Hopefully that helps on those two.
It certainly does. Vicky, I don't know if you've got anything to add to that, or shall I move on to my next question?
Just on the observatory, I would say that the progress that's been made is particularly around the kind of industry consultation piece, to kind of really understand the kind of data and insight that industry are looking to help inform their planning. And there has now been an industry panel or steering group, if you like, set up to guide that project, which I think will be very helpful in kind of focusing its priorities.
Okay, thank you. And going back to Rob, you mentioned something there about CapEx. The other area I wanted to ask about, the comment in the STERG's last minutes notes that the investment models have been challenging. And I think you comment about the financial accountability rules and the fact that the Scottish Government can't offer any flexibility. Is my understanding correct that that is simply a matter of the fact that the Scottish Government, by the rules by which it's bound in terms of the fiscal framework, cannot carry forward, and that is the implication of that? So they're in effect by law not in a position to offer flexibility, and therefore, if that is the correct, this issue around investment models and structuring them, are you any further forward with this real kind of blocker? So perhaps Rob, perhaps follows on what you were saying about CapEx.
Yeah, sorry, I missed my connection, maybe just broke in the middle of that, but I think I understood the question. So the rules are the rules, and they apply right across the UK in terms of the 31st of March. On capital expenditure, it's therefore crucially important that you make sure you have the plan in place and you can utilise the full extent of any 12 months in a financial year to deliver the planned expenditure. And I referred earlier to the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund, and the work we've been doing in the past 12 months is to precisely try and make sure that projects are able to start on the 1st of April. They have the full 12 months to spend the capital monies that are available, and they're not developing the projects during the course of that financial year. And certainly when it comes to capital expenditure, you know, that's, I think, in all my years of experience, both within local authorities and other public agencies, that's by far the best way of making sure that you can operate effectively in what are long established and well understood rules that you refer to in terms of capital expenditure. Does that respond to what you asked for? I did miss a bit in the middle of the question.
And what you're describing to me is careful management of the limitations where that sort of money can't be carried forward. But it does strike me that seems, you know, if I was running a business, as I have done, not being able to, particularly in CapEx, with all the implications that comes with it, that sounds like there's quite a lot of work associated with managing that limitation. And I suppose that's what I'm trying to explore, you know, and is that the case? Have you just got used to the idea that you're having to manage around that limitation, and you're incurring effort and therefore expenditure to do that?
I'm not sure if that's a commentary on my career, that perhaps I have just got used to it and accept that that's the way that you need to operate in order to make sure you make the best use of the funds that are available. Yeah. I think that's pretty correct.
And is there any other around the kind of, you know, the comment, there's no easy investment solutions, is there anything else you'd want to put on the record as well? You know, because obviously a lot of what we have seen has been exacerbated by the pandemic, you know, and free flow of funds, if you like. Anything else you want to put on the record in that?
I think the reality for businesses in Scotland, not just in the tourism sector, is that the impact of the pandemic has been significant in terms of draining their cash reserves, giving them confidence about revenue streams and cash flow, and therefore their ability to trade and be efficient is more challenged than it has been at any point in recent years. Even, I would go as far as say, perhaps more challenged than was the case in some of the immediate consequences of the financial crash in 2008. Trading out of this with confidence will, I think, be the most important thing. That's why the recovery focus for the next 12 to 24 months is so critical. We have to make sure we understand where businesses are doing well, and it's important to be clear that even in the course of a truncated season last year, many businesses did well, but where are businesses challenged? What support can we best put in place? How do we support their marketing efforts? What are the issues that need to be addressed? Some of that will be around investment in their own business. Some of it might be around national infrastructure and investment in infrastructure. public transport, ferries, for example, were mentioned earlier. These are all critically important parts in underpinning the national infrastructure to the success of businesses in remote and rural locations, as well as in the cities themselves when it comes to transport. So I think getting that balance right and understanding what will make the difference to these businesses in the next year or two is crucially important.
Okay, thank you for that. Vicky, do you have anything to add? I mean, obviously, I know Rob and I were focusing on CapEx and not being able to carry that forward, but you can carry forward revenue. But in around the area of investment, is there anything else you want to add before I move on? Because obviously, time is of the essence with the panel.
Yeah, I mean, I think, thank you for the question. Yes, I think going back to what I said is we need a year-round approach to Marketing Scotland, you know, and supporting things like connectivity, working with the airlines collaboratively to, particularly in relation to marketing, so that we're restoring their confidence that we're also building demand for Scotland and that helps to maintain the routes. So that does require a year-round approach and that therefore does require investment in both the domestic and international market. My team are clearly focused on that. It's very much a priority in terms of our core budget. But going back to what I said, you know, if we have more, then there is more we can clearly do with it. We can extend the reach of what we're able with our core.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now move on to Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. Note my register of interest around tourism. With a meeting with your chief executive the other day, explained how you'd been able to pivot your budget to be more focused on capital expenditure in readiness for return of tourism, which is obviously good for laying the foundations for long-term recovery. You know, the budget is, well, slightly down, you know, shows a sort of 50-50 split between resource and capital. Now, I'm guessing this might be a battle between destination development and marketing. I'm sure it's an amicable battle between yourselves. Can you maybe just comment on that 50-50 split and whether, given that CapEx has had the lion's share in the last year or so, should the pendulum have swung more the other way to marketing?
I think it might be helpful if we provide just some clarity about the numbers over past years so as we get a clear understanding of what capital and revenue has been, because there has been such changes in the last few years. And I think, like any public sector organisation, I only joined Visit Scotland in August last year, I think it's challenged about where at a point in time it places most emphasis and highest priority on the resources it has available. I've made clear in the comments earlier that I think capital investment requires careful long-term consideration, built out over perhaps 3, 5 or 7 years. I think the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund allows us to do that most effectively. Where capital investment is required in respect of Visit Scotland's own operations, you know, you would expect us to be efficient in the use of that capital, to invest that capital effectively, whether it's in digital and IT infrastructure or whether it's in the buildings and resources we have out and about throughout Scotland in the eye centres. And I think that's done pretty carefully and pretty effectively. The revenue investment is much more about the moment and the programmes that we need to run. I think, again, the recovery piece will drive those priorities in the short term and Outlook 2030 in the medium term. I don't know, Vicky may want to just say something more about how that's happened historically. You'll appreciate my backward look is only to August last year, but that's what I've experienced since then.
Yeah, no, that's correct, Rob. I think the thing I would pick up maybe just on the capital and investment, yeah, key area of investment for us has been, as an organisation, our kind of digital transformation programme, but because that's been about absolutely building capability, be able to get advice to industry in new ways, but also to reach consumers in new ways. And I think, you know, we've been able to, despite, you know, our focus being on funds and work such as the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Programme, while we've not been able to maybe accelerate some of that digital transformation activity as quickly as we would have liked, we are in a good place. There was a lot that we had done and put in place pre-pandemic, which allows us now to kind of turn our focus back to that. We have, for example, onboarded what we call a marketing automation platform. So that allows us to actually tailor you know, content and communications to visitors based on their interests real time on the website, but also through our email programme. So it allows us to be very efficient, to make our own channels much more efficient and effective in terms of delivering for Scotland. So that's been a kind of key focus for the organisation over the past few years with its capital programme.
Thank you very much. No more questions, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just before we close, can I ask, you answered questions earlier on phase one of the recovery programme and progress with that. You will appreciate there's a phase two of the recovery programme. This was an issue that the committee did raise with the Cabinet Secretary in terms of next year's budget, but there isn't a commitment for funding for phase two in the budget for next year. The Cabinet Secretary has indicated that she is supportive of the phase two, and I'm wondering if you're having discussions with the government about where any additional monies might come from, whether that's in your budgets or what we can expect in terms of trying to find resources to fund phase two. I don't, Rob, you might want to address that.
Yeah, I'm happy to address that, Convener. I chair STERG, so it's a constant conversation at present about how we balance the programme that was set out for year two of STERG that Mark Crothall referred to earlier on, against the position of currently not having funding. It's clearly encouraging that the Cabinet Secretary has indicated she's minded to provide resource if that's possible. Appreciate that might happen in the course of the budget decisions, it might happen in the course of the financial year. Either way, I think it's important we understand what the priorities are at any point in time. Assuming presently that there won't be any funding, I think it's been important through the STERG conversations that the national agencies prioritise their work quite clearly in relation to that programme. There was emphasis placed on things like international marketing, labour market shortages, visitor management earlier on in this morning's conversations, and the agencies that make up STERG are committed to making sure that work is taken forward. There's actually conversations tomorrow and again next week with government to consider how that programme might best be delivered. So it feels, from my perspective in chairing the group, that it's a fluid situation at present. I don't doubt the commitment of government and all the agencies and all local authorities to try and do the best they can in response to the challenges we face. But we all understand that public finances are tight and challenging, and we must prioritise the resources that are available. Does that hopefully give an indication of just where we are at this point in time?
Yes, that's very helpful. So I'd like to thank both of you for coming along this morning and speaking to us. And I will now move the meeting into private session.
Thank you.